I'm Otto Van Geet. I'm an engineer here at the National Renewable Energy Lab, and I've been here for 27 years and been involved in numerous PV projects here on our campus. When you start the selection process, you should figure out what the load is you're trying to meet. If you're trying to meet an on-site load, you want to get a year of utility bills, figure out what your utility rate structure is, figure out your electrical interconnection requirements. Is there net metering? Is there incentives? Those sorts of things. Then the next step in the process is, once you select the sites, to figure out possible electrical interconnection points and constraints. So we've considered dozens of sites here on our campus. It's about a 300-acre campus. We've considered ground mount, roof mount, and carports. For the ground mount sites, one of them we considered actually was the one in the background here. Great site, nice and flat, good utility interconnection, but it turns out we have future plans for that site. So what we settled on was a large ground-mounted site on our mesa top that was previously disturbed, and we put in about 3/4 of a megawatt of single-axis tracking on that site. Single-axis tracking requires very flat land, so they had to come out and do some grading, as you can see, for the land. The one constraint we had on this site is there's an existing 50-foot-wide easement for a natural gas line that we had to work around. When we went out to bid with that, we had the site plans drawn, including the 50-foot easement. In considering sites, bigger is better. The lowest cost solar will always be the largest, flattest, easy to interconnect piece of land. But again, you gotta make sure there's no future plans for that land. The next lowest cost will be large, flat, open rooftops, and the most expensive will be PV carports, because of the structure required for the PV carports.